on WebcastOneLive.com, the Legislative Hour with your hosts, Art Smith and Kevin Hall.
Good afternoon and welcome to the Iowa Legislative Hour. I am your host, Kevin Hall. Art Smith is off this week, but glad to be joined by two local House representatives, Jake Heifel, who has now become a semi-regular on the show. Jake, good to see you again.
Thank you for having me.
Glad to have you. And a first-time visitor to the show, Representative Chris Hagenow from Windsor Heights. Chris, good to see you.
First time here. I'm elated. This is going to be terrific.
So since it's your first time on the show, yeah, we need to do a little getting to know you. So just give us a little bit of your background. Chris, you were just reelected by the narrowest, yep, of margins.
I had the narrowest race in of all, however, 130-some in the, mm-hmm, state. So it was 23 votes in the,
wow,
end. But I get to come back, and that's an honor. So be coming back for a third term. And I live in Windsor Heights. I represent Clive, West Des Moines. In my day job, I'm an attorney downtown. My law partners, Matt Whitaker and Bill Gustoff, which some of your listeners might, mm-hmm, might know Matt. But and I also serve this year as the House Majority Whip in the House, so keeps me busy.
Since you brought up Mr. Whitaker, this is kind of a little bit off the topic, yeah, but he's expressing some interest in the U.S. Senate seat. What do you think about Matt and obviously, everybody's waiting to see what Steve, yeah, King's going to, yeah, do.
But. And so is Matt. Everybody's waiting to see what happens, yeah, there. No, yeah, look, Matt is my law partner. He's my friend. And I have a lot of respect for him and his leadership skills. And he's an incredibly bright guy with, and he's accomplished a lot in his, mm-hmm, in his life, both professionally and in other things. A lot of people recognize him as a former Hawkeye athlete.
And, yep.
I joke with him. You can tell when he's got an important meeting, he'll break out the Rose Bowl ring. So it's always a tip off. But yes. No, I think he'd be a very strong candidate.
I do too.
And you know, we talk about as a party trying to figure out what kind of candidates can we have that can make it through Republican primaries and also be very strong general election candidates. Mm-hmm. And I think that Matt fits that mold very well. So he's very interested, and I'm excited to see what happens.
Excellent. Well, let's talk about what's been going on at the Capitol this week, because there's been a lot of interesting debate, maybe not necessarily a whole lot of action in terms of getting things passed. But Jake, one thing this week, there was a public hearing to discuss Medicaid expansion. And, of course, the big battle is that which Democrats are pushing as opposed to Governor Branstad's Healthy Iowa program. Tell us about the hearing, which I know you were there for Tuesday evening.
The hearing went great, actually. We had Chuck Soderberg, which is our chair of appropriations, and the ranking member, Tyler Olson, the Democrats, be the speaker for the day. So after we gaveled out, they came here. We had five people that were pro-Medicaid expansion and five people pro-Governor Branstad. And I will tell you what, the people that spoke against Medicaid were very well respected. They were people in our communities and our districts. I had Jill Ellsworth. Mm-hmm. You know Jill, probably. Yep. She came and spoke, and she's not a politician. She's nothing like a very common person. Mm-hmm. Came and spoke against it. Why we should do Iowa plan, not federal government plan. We can't afford it. We had great people, and I swear to you, the Democrats had every lobbyist, AARP, every big time. All they're in it for the money. Why they want to expand Medicaid. Speaking on their behalf, but we had an Army Ranger. We had people that were living here, not dedicated to public service and money. They're like, we really think this is the best way to go. So I think we did a great job with that. The hearing went great. Some unions spoke for the Democrats as well. That surprised you at all.
Yeah.
And also want to raise minimum wage and everything else. That we're terrible people, but yeah, it went really well, and I'm kind of happy about it. They they expected hundreds of thousands of people to come, mm-hmm, like they always do, and they probably had 40 there.
Hmm.
And they filled the galleries, but not much besides that. It went really well. I'm glad we get our message across. So,
what's the next step now? Because I'm hearing a lot of people think you guys will be done with the session May 3rd, and then this might, because it kind of has to wait on the federal government and what they're going to decide to do, if they're going to allow Governor Branstad's plan.
Yeah, with regard to the waiver, on the broader issue of when we adjourn, I think it's becoming clear that May 3rd is just a real long shot now, but the things are moving. We kind of inside the building speak, the paper's moving, mm-hmm, the progress we make, and things are, the appropriation bills are moving, going to conference committee. And so you can kind of see that coming together. Although that having been said, there's some very big differences that have to be bridged before we can get there. I think I could see us going into the first or second week of May and possibly getting it done in there, assuming we can bridge some of those differences. If not, I don't want to think about what happens after. We got to get it done.
What are your thoughts personally on the Medicaid expansion and comparing that to Governor Branstad's bill?
Well, it comes down to whether you want an Iowa-based plan that's got some accountability in it, or you want to continue to pour a lot of borrowed money from the federal government mm-hmm. into a broken system. And that's what it is. This is just, if you want to pour more money at a problem and hope for different results, then I would think that the straight Medicaid expansion would be the plan for you. If you want to try and do something different to help improve people's lives, help it find more cost-effective ways in the out years to get this done, then I think we should look at a new idea and try this. And so I'm optimistic we can get something done in that. But I think, you know, going back to the idea of this being borrowed money, the people I talk to that aren't associated with, you know, the Hospital Association mm-hmm. or AARP, they very much instinctively understand that the federal government in their current path fiscally is unsustainable, and they have every reason to believe that the federal government will not be able to live up to these promises. And then when that falls off, it comes back on the states to fill up that gap, and none of us want to go there.
And just to remind the listeners, basically the federal government is promising they will fully fund the Medicaid expansion for the first 3 years, yeah. and then it'll gradually drop down to 90% by, right. I think, 2020.
Right.
Governor Branstad does not trust the federal government,
right.
with good reason.
Who does?
Yeah. So he's kind of devised his own plan.
And you know, one thing, if the federal government promises that they're not going to fund something fully in the future, that is a promise you can take to the bank.
Yes. Yeah. You know, Jack Hatch got up on the Senate floor, because you guys are in the House, not the Senate, but just railing against Governor Branstad last week and saying he doesn't know anything about health care, even though he was president of
TMU,
the 15th yeah. largest medical school in the nation for 6 years. You know, what do you think about this whole debate and kind of the way people are behaving in regards to
it? Well, I really think the hospitals are going to get behind us, because of the fact that when they come to us and whine about they're not getting reimbursed enough for Medicaid from the federal government, mm-hmm. they understand that we cannot expand a program that they don't get reimbursed for in the first place. That's just, they're getting 36 cents for pharmaceutical drugs, 44 cents for some of the procedures, so they're losing money as it is. They know we cannot expand a program that they already don't make money on.
Yeah.
They understand that completely. And I'll tell you something about Jack Hatch, and if I told you this or not, but we were behind the Senate talking to Senator Whitford and whatnot, and he came back there, and we go, well, we really worry about the national debt, our kids, my generation especially, and he just goes, I don't give a bleep about the federal debt. It's not my concern. I was like, we look at him like, you don't care about the federal debt? That's our biggest problem right now. It's not domestic terrorists. It's right here, national debt.
Did you actually hear him say that?
Yeah, I was right there with him.
Okay, so you heard Jack Hatch, state senator who is considering running for governor of the state of Iowa, say,
I don't give a F-bomb about the federal debt. It was me. Whitford was talking to him. I was back there standing out. And then Zahn was in the Senate, and I was sitting to Jack. Jack Whitford was talking to him. And Jack goes, the difference between me and you is I do care about that. It's why I ran for office. And I'm sitting there. I was about 10 feet away, and I'm sitting there like this. I had a simple question for talk to Jack about something else, and I was waiting for him to get done with this conversation. I was like, oh, okay. It was a little interesting.
Chris,
I was not part of that conversation.
So you're hearing this secondhand.
Yeah.
And Hatch has been a legislator for many years. He's been in the House right. and the Senate. I think he stepped down out of the House to work for Tom Harkin for a couple years back in the 90s. He doesn't give an F about the debt.
I will say Jack Hatch is a bright guy. He's been very successful in business. He's also a very liberal Democrat.
Yes.
And obviously, with that perspective, that's going to drive his policy decisions. And you also got to understand that he's one of the leading candidates to run against Governor Branstad next mm-hmm. fall. And so I suspect that you would see Senator Hatch would not like the governor's plan, regardless of what was in it, just if for no other reason than political positioning.
Right.
He knows a lot about healthcare policy, but it's a lot about the liberal perspective on healthcare policy. And but that's frustrating if that is in fact his perspective on debts and deficit, because I'm with Jake. That's one of the key reasons I ran for office, and we've done what in Iowa, we've done a great job of putting together a balanced budget. But at the federal level, you continue to just, it's unconscionable what we're doing with the federal deficit and the debts that we're racking up. And it's just frankly immoral.
Yeah. You are watching the Iowa Legislative Hour. Kevin Hall, I am your host, and we are joined by State Representatives Jake Heifel and Chris Hagenell, Jake from Johnston, Chris from Windsor Heights, and talking about what is going on with Medicaid expansion. And Representative Heifel just dropped a bomb on the show saying that State Senator Jack Hatch from Des Moines actually said in front of some Republican representatives that, quote, "I don't give an F." And he used the term about the debt.
Yeah, and I'll tell you one thing, though. Wow. Our philosophical difference is that he believes, even if you believe in big government that solves all your problems, you have to still pay for it. That is, you know, say you believe that government should take care of health care, everything else, you still have to pay for it. But they don't believe in paying for it. They speak, oh, it's all free money, we're just borrowing it.
This is still our tax dollars, is it not?
Tax dollars.
Whether the federal government's using it or the state's using it, this is still our tax dollars.
Yep. No, and that is that disconnect is incredibly frustrating. This idea, well, it's federal government money or it's free money or whatever. It is our tax dollars, yours and mine and our neighbors.
It's not even tax dollars anymore. It's borrowing money.
Well, that's true, too.
we're at the point where we are borrowing
it's
money.
It's China's money.
Yeah.
Unbelievable. So, on that note, what else is going on in the state capital? Of course, education reform has been a very hot topic lately. Any updates on that?
The conference committee met again today, I believe over the noon hour, sometime late morning. The Senate actually had a counter proposal now, which is encouraging. But the fundamental dynamic there, I don't think has changed dramatically, is that House Republicans made a bold offer. The Senate Democrats drew a line in the sand with regard to the funding. House Republicans says, we'll meet you there, and here are the other changes, the reforms that we want to see happen within the said reform bill. In addition, you have some additional freedoms for our private schoolers and our homeschoolers. So we will meet your funding demands, but here are some other reasonable changes that we'd like to make that would help our students across the board. And those are important to us. And so if we're going to spend this extra money, here's some other things we'd like to get done. And that needs to happen for us to get this done. And so we'll see where it comes out.
Now, I've heard today in the conference committee, and I don't know if you know much about this or not, but there was a little bit of progress. At least the Senate Republicans felt there was a little bit of progress made.
Yeah, there's a big stumbling block with regard to a early intervention block grant, where that gets funded. The Senate Democrats think that we are not going to fund it, even though we included it in our budget and it's accounted for. But so it really almost seems like where in that balance sheet you stick a certain sum of money. And if that's all it is, I would sure think we could get that resolved.
And Jake, we talked about this last week, the 4-4, the Democrats have railed for a long time about how they want 4% allowable growth for the next 2 years. That is the price. If Governor Branstad wants, and if the House Republicans want their education reforms, the cost is 4% allowable growth for the next 2 years. That was offered to them, and that wasn't good enough.
I don't know if you saw this or not, but Governor Branstad has a little YouTube clip on his website right now with Senator Kornbach and Senator
Rob Hogue from Cedar
Hogue,
Rapids.
Hogue saying 4% more than once on the floor. Mm-hmm. And we gave it to them, and they don't want it. That just kind of proves the fact that they just want to throw money at a problem instead of actually having a solution with, you know, independent accreditation, different things we have in our plan. So, and the funny thing is now is that Iowa School Board Association, everybody is on our side now. They switched to the House Republican plan. They want that 4%. They want the growth. They want everything else. As we walked in here today, I got an email for the counteroffer from Ron Jorgensen and some of our, and Cecil Dolchek, who's our representatives in the House in the conference committee. They actually bumped up the salary to $33,500 minimum, which doesn't affect very many schools, actually.
That's for starting teachers.
Teachers. Mm-hmm. And a few other things that we are going to bump up for them. But still, we keep saying that if you don't bring our language, you will get nothing. And actually, the Democrats are getting hammered about this because we gave them the money, we want the reform, and we're willing to put it up. Only if we have the reform. Otherwise, I really do believe Governor Branstad will not go forward. If we don't have reform, it won't be 4%.
Yeah, the video I thought was fantastic, set to the Jackson's 5, ABC, 1, 2, 3, and using the Democrats' own words, mm-hmm. the cost of it is 4%, and it's kind of gone viral now.
I was speaking this morning up at the Capitol in the hallway with a prominent Iowa Democratic leader, and he kind of, what do you think is going to happen on education reform? I said, you know, I don't know for sure, because there's a lot to do here, but I said, don't discount how much it's taken to get House Republicans to come to this point. Mm-hmm. And you guys better be really careful that you don't mess this up, because you've got a really attractive offer here. And if you walk away from this, it could look really bad. And he completely understood what I was saying.
And so, originally you guys had offered 2%.
Mm-hmm.
That was the original House Republican plan. So you guys have compromised mm-hmm. and given them what they wanted in terms of the yep. funding, which, sadly, it seems like the funding is the most important thing 99% of the time with Democrats.
Well, since Governor Branch took office last time, school funding percent of the budget has gone from about 35% to, I think it's about 61% now. Mm-hmm. And education is only getting worse. We know that throwing money at a problem is not the answer. So we're trying to do something. This is a step in the right direction. I don't think it's the perfect, fix-all solution, but I really do believe that some of the stuff is worth paying for. And like Chris said earlier, you have no idea how hard it is to get our very, very conservative caucus to support 4%. Yes. Yeah. If we don't have our language in there, there will not be 4%.
And Representative Hagenow, you touched on this a little bit, but let's talk about some of the reforms that, mm-hmm. that are being offered in that education plan.
Well, I know that... For me, particularly, some of the ones that I'm most excited about are surrounding school choice, which mm-hmm. has always been one of my core issues that I've advocated for at the Capitol. For our private school families, they have independent accreditation so that our private schools don't have to adhere to the Department of Education standards to get accredited, but the independent ones for whatever organization they seek. And in most cases, those are actually more stringent than the ones offered at the state level. So mm-hmm. that's a tremendous freedom. And if you talk to any private school administrator, they will tell you that's very important to them. And then for our homeschool families, you have a certified private instruction, the independent instruction, and parent-taught driver's education. Mm-hmm. And I come at it for our homeschool families is they just need the freedom. It's parental freedom, parental rights type of an issue. They should be... have the power and liberty to raise their children however they see fit. And so I think they're important pieces of legislation to empower them. So I'm very excited about that. Inside of the reform with regard to public education, you've got some student achievement measures. You've got some teacher training, mentoring, assessment measures that we need to try these things. We need to do better inside of our public schools, because that's the core of our educational system. And we've got private homeschool, but the core needs to be a very well-functioning public education system. And that doesn't need to be a partisan issue. And we should be about making sure that we get the maximum value out of our investment in public education.
Absolutely. Representative Heifel, I've heard a few Democrats rail against this idea that homeschooling parents shouldn't be teaching driver's ed to their kids. And that one just boggles my mind, because if there's one topic, that most kids learn from their parents, I think it's driving, in regards to education. Mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of people go through the driver's ed classes, but to me, that just seems like a no brainer.
Well, I was 10 years old. My dad taught me way before I was, driver's ed class, because, we're working a farm or somewhere else. I have to drive something. Mm-hmm. And so I did that when I lived in Nebraska when I was younger. But it just makes so much sense to me to have parents. The numbers don't lie. Homeschoolers tend to have better scores than ACT, SAT, and everything else. Private schools have better than public education. I don't know why they're so against choice. I really do believe freedom to go send your kids wherever you like is one of the most important things of education. Hopefully one day we could get something similar to a voucher system. We don't have to send our kids to wherever school they're located in and say, oh, that's not school, doesn't work for me. Let's go to Ankeny. Let's go to Johnston. Let's go to Dowling. Mm-hmm. I really do believe that's the next step after this education plan, so we can really have some choice, have some competition in the education market.
So what part of Nebraska were you in when you were a kid?
South Sioux City, Nebraska.
Okay. So are you a Husker fan or Hawkeye fan? Because you went to University of Iowa.
I was a diehard Husker fan until I went to Iowa.
And you've been converted.
I've been converted.
seen the light.
I was a diehard Husker fan to the point where I had Eric Crouch signed jerseys, everything. And then I went to Iowa, and I actually had some friends on the team, guys I went to class with and hung out with, and then I switched. But I still cheer for the Huskers, but I am a Hawkeye fan through and through.
Representative Hagenau Hawkeyes?
I bleed black and gold.
Okay.
It feels good, too.
We're talking with Representative Chris Hagenau and Representative Jake Heifel. This is the Iowa Legislative Hour. Lots more to get to, including the bottle bill being debated in the legislature, as well as eminent domain. That and more when the Iowa Legislative Hour continues here on Westwood One, Webcast One Live.
From the RE/MAX Real Estate Concept Studios, this is Webcast One Live.
If you choose to obey the power of sin, it leads to death. If you choose to obey obedience, it leads to righteousness.
Forgiveness is just the beginning of life in Christ. God wants us to live for Him now.
And because of Jesus Christ, the gospel was preached, and you and I are blessed today because of Abraham. Did you know that? We're blessed.
Experience Truth, 99.3 FM.
Drug and alcohol addiction slowly steals a person's identity, tearing away pieces of their life little by little until one day it seems like the hope of a happy future is gone and there's no chance of getting it back. Here at St. Gregory Retreat Centers, we can assure you that there is hope. Our unique approach to recovery begins with the understanding that the dysfunction and damage caused by addiction can be overcome, not just dealt with. Don't let another day go by. Call St. Gregory today.
Whether you're 10, 25, 50, 80 years old and beyond, everyone needs to live within their means. I'm Tom Coates with Consumer Credit of America. For almost a quarter of a century, we've helped people of all ages learn to manage their personal finances to benefit them far into the future. When problems arise, we've got the experience you need to make those debt problems go away. Got financial problems? Call Consumer Credit of America.
The only way we come to know the saviorship of Jesus Christ is by bowing and acknowledging that He is Lord and King over all the earth.
Jesus Christ died on a cross, paid the penalty for our sin, and by repenting of our sin and accepting Him by faith, what He did for us, we are forgiven.
Salvation is not a combination of faith and works. Salvation is by faith alone in God.
Experience Truth, 99.3 FM.
From the RE/MAX Real Estate Concept Studios, this is Webcast One Live.
We're back on the Iowa Legislative Hour. I'm your host, Kevin Hall, and joining us this week is Representative Jake Heifel from Johnston, Representative Chris Hagenau from Windsor Heights. Did I say that right?
Yeah, that's the best you've done so far today.
Hang on. Your mic's not on. There we go.
All right. That was the best effort so far today. You nailed it.
Hagenau.
Yeah. Good. Yeah.
Good enough?
Good. Above average.
Above, okay. Close enough. Usually that only counts in horseshoes and hand grenades. No. But let's talk about a contentious issue all around the nation, and that being abortion. Every year the pro-life community is hammering on the legislature, lobbying you guys. They want, obviously, would like to abolish all abortions, but also want to strip taxpayer funding from abortions. And we thought that got done a few years ago and put into the budget, and then there was it never did get inserted into the Iowa code. Today, Senator Amy Sinclair from Allerton, that's down in Wayne County in southern Iowa, she offered an amendment to the human services budget in the Senate that would prohibit taxpayer-funded abortion. One Democrat crossed over, Joe Singh, who's from out in eastern Iowa, but it still did not pass. Is there a chance of getting something done with that this year?
Sadly, the fundamental roadblocks in the Senate. And so I think, I hate to be pessimistic, I think the answer to that lies in that vote that happened today. Mm. Now, to kind of come back around on that, House Republicans, it's not just a social conservative issue. This is a fiscal conservative issue.
Right.
Should our tax dollars be used to fund abortions? We disagree. We don't believe that it should. So we're going to stand up for that. The voters of Iowa, in their infinite wisdom, have elected conservative Republicans to the Iowa House and some of the more liberal people in the state of Iowa to the state Senate. And so we have to work within that. We're going to fight. We're going to see what we can get done. I don't know the outcome yet.
Okay. Jake, what do you think about that?
This is my first term, but I'm learning a lot about the dynamic of how this really works. And trust me, I'm pro-life 100%. I think it's one of the most important issues we have. And I will tell you one thing. I we might do something in the House, try to strip it out of any of our budgets and maybe go to conference committee. That'd be something we can probably maybe hold on to in conference committee, because that'd be great. Even if you are pro-choice, I don't agree with you, Hunter, at all. But you still should believe that we should, your tax dollars should not be paid for somebody else's health care.
Mm-hmm. And Chris, you know, some in the pro-life community, their argument is every year it's still it's still there in the budget. And in the end, because you have to get a budget passed, there's still that vote taken. And so it's still there.
Yep. I'm one of them. Yeah. I'm one of those. How I see myself is a member of the pro-life community.
Mm-hmm.
I just happen to be able to get to push the button up there at the Capitol. And we're doing the most we can. At the end of the day, we're talking about the Health and Human Services budget.
Right.
And that what's very frustrating is this issue is woven inside of a bill and a budget that provides services that are core services that Iowans need.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's only a certain amount of brinksmanship that you can put on this before you start talking about the services that we really do need to be delivering to Iowans. And we've got to figure that out.
Jake, there was a poll done by, I believe it was the NBC Wall Street Journal poll last week. And we've kind of seen this play out in other polls where 53% of Americans now support gay marriage. So it seems the tide in that regard is kind of going against conservatives. However, the same poll showed 52% of Americans believe abortions should be banned either completely or in most cases. So do you feel public sentiment is kind of moving the Republicans' way and conservatives' way on this issue?
We are losing a lot of social issues, but I would tell you one thing, we're not going to lose the pro-life movement. I really do believe that we are going to the right, and people understand that this is really a problem, especially with what just happened. What I just learned about this week was going on in Pennsylvania, that sick doctor. It makes you want to throw up how disgusting he was.
Yeah.
But stuff like that, I really do believe even in my generation, younger generation, it's a very important issue. They're very socially libertarian on a lot of issues. Mm-hmm. And I'll tell you what, gay marriage, and when it comes to my generation, is almost a dead issue. But when it comes to pro-life, it is heartbeat. It's probably, even a lot of Democrats are very pro-life. I went back to the middle school and I had kids lobbying me all day. Talk about fun, by the way. The issues that eighth graders bring up aren't issues that us taxpayers would bring up. And, I get my paycheck and I'm always like, ugh, more taxes, They brought up, I had the 14 of the first 23 kids or whatever it was lobbying me on pro-life bills.
Wow.
All of them. And I called some of my people in the district, Denise Bubeck, and some other people. I'm like, you're not going to believe what just happened. I was with my young intern, and she looked at me, and she goes, you got to be kidding me. I go, because I was 14 years old. I was more worried about what's drive at 14 and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But when they're 14, 15 years old, and they're bringing up, I like this bill. And they give me all these facts about it, why I should support it. I'm like, trust me, I would support that bill in a heartbeat. It was really an upbringing moment. And it really was happening. Some of the fun issues they're talking about was like golf carts and fun bills like that. But I'll tell you what, when it comes to pro-life, they're telling me that they can't believe it's still illegal in the United States. And I completely understand. And that was a really great awakening for the next generation.
Wow. Are you sensing the same thing?
I very much do. And I think it's a broad generational shift that you're seeing. You're seeing a generation of parents, of moms and dads that have seen their unborn children.
Right.
And when they've seen them. And I know for my own children to see them that first time in the womb, it is a remarkable experience. And some of those technologies didn't exist in the past at the time of Roe. And it was, I think, easier for a previous generation to see that as some lifeless clump of cells.
Mm-hmm.
And so you see time and time, and maybe Jake is fair amount younger than I am, and some of the folks in his middle school. I mean, these are children who may at one point mom and dad have shown them the picture of them in the womb unborn.
Yeah.
Because now they're old enough that's been around. And throw it on top of that, every time you have something in the news like this Kermit Gosnell trial, and you see the horror of what this is, the end result, that drives public opinion.
Mm-hmm.
And that's inescapable. And so as time moves on, I believe that hearts and minds will be changed. And ultimately, I believe that if you want to make the real progress on life in the public arena, mm-hmm. at the Capitol, at the U.S. Capitol, that comes from a changing of hearts and minds,
yes.
among the people. Yep. And when that happens, then we will get the legislation that reflects that.
You know, I write this Sunday column for the IowaRepublican.com that's kind of a snarky take on the week. And I tried to write about the Gosnell trial, and I just, there wasn't much. I mean, I literally was getting sick to my stomach, mm-hmm. just saying, so I just wrote one little sentence about it. I mean, it's just disgusting. I mean, it's an abomination. I don't know.
There's a special place in hell for people like that.
Yes, mm-hmm. I agree.
Well, and I think that's the struggle. Look, I think the media, some of them don't want to cover this story, but I think some of them that are honest are maybe in the same boat that you are. They don't know how to write about mm-hmm. that. And it doesn't fit inside any of their kind of their typical silos that they write stories in. Is this just a crime story? Is this just a social issue story? And it doesn't fit in that. And I think some of them shied away just because they don't quite get what to do with it. And that's unfortunate because I think the American people need to know what's going on.
Absolutely. Secretary of State Matt Schultz filled in for Rick Santorum. The 2012 Iowa caucus winner was supposed to be mm-hmm. here in Iowa on Monday, and he was going to speak along with at the Faith and Freedom Coalition dinner. He's going to speak at the John Paul II Medical Research Institute fundraiser in downtown Des Moines on Monday. And Matt, literally every speech he's given in the last 4 years has been about voter ID. He's you know, sung its praises. Mm-hmm. This is one speech where he didn't talk about voter ID except at the beginning, just to tell the crowd, mm-hmm. I'm not going to talk about voter ID. And he talked about he and his wife were going to have their third child. And about 5 months into the pregnancy, they found out there were some complications and that the baby was probably going to die in the womb within a week. And it was such a powerful speech. Mm-hmm. It was very Santorum-esque, if you remember
yep.
some of the speeches he gave in Iowa that really yep. you know, led him from the bottom of the pack to the top. And, you know, so many couples go through that. Yeah. And it was just an amazing speech. And I think you're right about the science of the issue. When you can see the picture of the baby inside the womb, I think that, you know, the science of the issue shows that that is an actual life in there.
Yep.
I think that's making a big difference.
I don't know if you saw in North Dakota what they did. Mm-hmm. 5 weeks, they have a heartbeat and they have two monitors. And that just proves to you, you show somebody at 5 weeks, they have a heartbeat, that's a life. That's
yeah.
a life right there. And I think North Dakota did a great thing and hopefully it'll stick it up in court. That's always our biggest worry. And hopefully Iowa can take steps in the right direction in the next few years. I think we can.
Let's change topics a little bit. One of the bills being debated in the legislature is the bottle bill.
And just a small departure from the last topic.
Yeah. Let's get away from that and talk about this because you have a personal bone to pick.
I have a personal bone.
With this.
I have a very personal bone with this bill. I was born a Hy-Vee baby. My dad's been a Hy-Vee for 38 years. My mom's been a Hy-Vee they met a Hy-Vee 30-something years. My sister's first job was a Hy-Vee. My first job was a Hy-Vee. All my family's Hy-Vee. It's a family. It's a cult, too, by the way. If you're my father thinks Hy-Vee's the only job anybody should ever have. Yeah. He's totally convinced of it. So when I got this, I was pushing carts for him when I was like 10, 11 years old in Nebraska. When I moved to Iowa, my first job, day I turned 14, I already had the job. I went to Johnston Hy-Vee, and I was a beggar, 14 years old, bottom of the barrel. So every time the light would go off, the mechanic had to go clean the bottle rooms.
Ugh.
Talk about the most disgusting experience of your life. Pop and beer and mm-hmm. whiskey and tobacco all mixed together.
Yeah.
Then you have to walk this giant crate back through the store. Because it's snowing outside, obviously, you can't push the car on the outside. So you walk through the produce. I'm sitting there like, this is not sanitary at all.
No.
You have to go sort the bottles in the back all the way through. And now they want to expand it to 10 cents, and they want to bring water bottles just like this one right here. And you look at them like, you know what? We are in the 21st century. This is not, you know, back in the 60s and 70s when this started. We have recycling on our curbs. Johnston has recycling. West Des Moines recycling. We should just get rid of the bottle bill and have recycling where people, out of the goodness of their heart, will recycle and do the right thing instead of having the stores mandate. Because right now, the stores are losing money, about a cent and a half per bottle. People don't know that. So you have these kids that clean the bottle rooms, disgusting, sanitary reasons. So we have full-time people, they're losing money, and they're going to lose more money if they expand. So that's one of the...
How are they losing money?
Because the bags, the machines, and the labor, always costs more. They used to make money, but over time with inflation and everything else, they lose about every bottle they bring back. It's about a cent and a half. They lose money because it takes a lot of maintenance. Because every, I think it's 250 cans, you have to come in and bring, change the bag, have somebody do that. You know, it takes labor. Yeah.
You got to pay for the next representative, Jake Heifeld, empty the machine. So you got a labor cost.
And I made like $5.50 back then, but and I'm not even that old. But now it's an older people job. People are doing it full time now because hire a full time person. That's your job, 40 hours a week, which isn't the most pleasant job. So right now the bottle bill passed the Senate subcommittee. Senator Whitford was actually on it. Obviously he voted no for it.
And let's explain what is in this new bottle bill.
They want to expand water, Gatorade, everything else, and actually add 10 cents to it.
So it would be plastic bottles, glass bottles as well. Okay. And a 5 cent charge.
Glass is already on it right now. If you don't, so that when you have the machines, you have the glass, the cans, and then you have the bigger glass, which is wine bottles and everything else.
Yeah.
So this will add basically the plastic to it.
Okay.
So they passed, and I heard through the grapevine, and they have the votes to pass it out of the Democratic Senate. So I emailed our appropriations chair, and I told him, Chuck, if it comes over here, I want to kill it. That's what I want to do. So this is personal. It's coming back, and I'm ready. Yeah. I'm ready for this.
Would that be your huge triumph of your freshman session?
I wouldn't campaign on it, but I'd be personally, it would be very exciting for me.
Representative Hagen out the bottle bill.
Representative Heifel and I have been eager to take on this fight since before either one of us got elected again last fall. So no, we're at the same. My wife on her 16th birthday was dropped off at the front door of the Grinnell Hy-Vee and said, "Here's your job, get to work." And she worked back at the customer service counter without the machines, people setting the trays of cans and bottles up, and she's got some very disgusting stories.
Yeah,
pretty much any sort of substance imaginable is put into and so it's just if for no other reason do we want to walk into the grocery store and walk past this when we go in there's got to be a better way. And so I Jake's right, we got curbside recycling all over the state now. Let's go ahead and use that. And if we need to do other, if there's some other mechanism that for folks that don't have that, that we'll look at that. But it's just, it's not something that I want to have in my grocery store.
I'll tell you one thing. My dream would be get rid of the bottle bill altogether, but I doubt that happens. But I will compromise if you can just get it out of the stores and put it somewhere else. So we don't have this disgusting stuff in the store. Stores are mandated to take them back because it's kind of a hypocritical thing. Hy-Vee and Walmart and Target take them back, but Casey's sells beer too. Casey's sells pop too. Mm-hmm. You ever seen one of those machines in Casey's or Come and Go? So it's kind of one of those things that if we get it out of the store, that'd be a moral win. It's not everything I want, but I would support something to get it out of the stores.
I agree with you on that. Dan, do we have that video? Okay, we talked about this a little bit earlier, the education debate going on at the state capitol. Governor Branstad's team has put together a little video of the Democrats in their own words. Let's take a look at that.
World-class schools for all of the kids in Iowa, you gotta pay for it. Okay, Governor, if that's your choice, then 4% is the price of education reform.
In a meeting that only lasted 5 minutes, House Republicans offered a compromise on education reform.
We would be willing to consider for fiscal year 14 a 2% increase in allowable growth plus a 2% one-time equivalent payment on top of that.
Plus another 4% in 2015.
Come on, come on, come on, let me show you what it's all about. 4% is what they need in order to do their duty to their kids.
That that's awesome. I mean, that is so well done, using their own words against them. And that's what the House Republicans agreed to. You guys said, okay, we'll give you the money.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. One thing that I've noticed over the last year or two, maybe longer, is just how good Republicans and conservatives are getting at social media,
mm-hmm.
and getting our message out through new media. And so this is just one of those ways to do it. A quick YouTube ad to really simply convey the message that, yeah, you know what? It's about the money. So here's some, you know, we're going to meet that, but let's actually make a change.
I've heard some tempers flared over on the left side of the aisle after watching that video too. Have you heard the same thing around the Capitol?
You should have seen, I was there. You should have seen Kornbach's face when, Representative Jorgensen said that. He's like, well, what do we do now? So he basically called the meeting. He goes, I need to think about it. They did not see it coming. It was a great hit. It was like, they did not think we'd go to 4%. No. And I didn't either at first. And then we're willing to pay for it if we get our education reform. Yeah. So
well played. We'll see what happens in the next few weeks on that. We are visiting with Representative Jake Heifel and Representative Chris Hagenow from the Iowa Legislature. Talk about eminent domain and tax reform when we continue. You're watching the Iowa Legislative Hour on Webcast One Live.
From the RE/MAX Real Estate Concept Studios, this is Webcast One Live.
If you choose to obey the power of sin, it leads to death. If you choose to obey obedience, it leads to righteousness.
Forgiveness is just the beginning of life in Christ. God wants us to live for Him now.
And because of Jesus Christ, the gospel was preached, and you and I are blessed today because of Abraham. Did you know that? We're blessed.
Experience Truth, 99.3 FM.
Drug and alcohol addiction slowly steals a person's identity, tearing away pieces of their life little by little until one day it seems like the hope of a happy future is gone and there's no chance of getting it back. Here at St. Gregory Retreat Centers, we can assure you that there is hope. Our unique approach to recovery begins with the understanding that the dysfunction and damage caused by addiction can be overcome, not just dealt with. Don't let another day go by. Call St. Gregory today.
Whether you're 10, 25, 50, 80 years old and beyond, everyone needs to live within their means. I'm Tom Coates with Consumer Credit of America. For almost a quarter of a century, we've helped people of all ages learn to manage their personal finances to benefit them far into the future. When problems arise, we've got the experience you need to make those debt problems go away. Got financial problems? Call Consumer Credit of America.
The only way we come to know the saviorship of Jesus Christ is by bowing and acknowledging that He is Lord and King over all the earth.
Jesus Christ died on a cross, paid the penalty for our sin, and by repenting of our sin and accepting Him by faith, what He did for us, we are forgiven.
Salvation is not a combination of faith and works. Salvation is by faith alone in God.
Experience Truth, 99.3 FM.
From the RE/MAX Real Estate Concept Studios, this is Webcast One Live.
And we are back on the Iowa Legislative Hour. I'm your host, Kevin Hall, along with Representative Jake Heifel from Johnston, Representative Chris Hagenow from Windsor Heights. I think I've been consistent the last two times.
It gets better every time you do it.
Let's talk about another topic that conservatives, this is a big issue to them, and that being eminent domain. And that's being discussed at the legislature. Jake, tell us a little bit about what's going on with that.
Actually, I'm the person behind the scenes helping out a lot with Bobby Coffin. Representative Bobby Coffin from Wilton, which is the South. Mm-hmm. He's the only Republican to get elected in Johnson County in a long time.
Well, actually, they had a supervisor in a special election just a couple months ago, which I think that was the first time in 55 years a Republican was elected to the Board of Supervisors there. But yeah, continue. Bobby Coffin, he's a fellow freshman.
He's a fellow freshman.
University of Iowa graduate.
Yes, he is. Mm-hmm. He's a good friend of mine, too. So he has been, this is a big issue. Right now, they're taking a land in Clark County to basically make it so they have a reservation, but they can vote and everything else on that. They're taking one of our fellow caucus members, which is Joel Fry. Mm-hmm. So Joel Fry, they're taking his family farm. It's been the family forever to build a resort water place, a water park on it, basically.
And this is the Osceola area, Osceola Clark area. County.
So okay. Bobby Kaufman has a bill that basically says you have to prove, that your water is for public good. It has to be for, you know, obviously drinking water, everything like that, it's fine, but it cannot be for recreational purpose. You can't build condos on it. Has to be only for the public good. And our Iowa's laws are pretty liberal about this, actually, so we're making it very strict possible. This is not just a Republican issue. This is a bipartisan issue. The first time it passed the House, it was 94-4. The second time, Senate Democrats
said, which the bill basically says what? The
bill basically says that you have to go to court, and you can, if you take somebody else's property for eminent domain purposes, it has to be only for public service. It cannot be for private commercial like they're doing right now. Mm-hmm. So if, for example, it has to be for water, interstate, highway, or something like that, but it cannot be for any commercial use. You can't put condos on it. It has to be proven in court instead of just saying, oh, this is for public good. Makes it harder to take people's land, basically what the bill does.
So Representative Kaufman's bill has passed the House overwhelmingly. And is anything being done about it in the Senate?
No. Well, actually, Senator Zahn, Senator Woodford, and Senator Shelgren, I went over there and helped Bobby out and introduce them because they're actually live close to me.
Right.
So he went over there and they all tried to attach his bill to a different bills, and two of them were ruled ungermane at the time. But what we did then, we took a very... bill, it was probably ungermane in the House, but we added it on again. We added it again. We sent the bill over three times now. So we sent the same bill over three times, and now it's in the Senate. Wait for them to take the play. This is a very important bill for the state of Iowa, for landowners, for both parties. And when Bruce Hunter and I and Bobby Kaufman and all those lefties voting the same bill for it, that's saying it's an important bill.
Let's clarify. Bruce Hunter being one of the most liberal members.
Yes.
But not Bobby Kaufman.
He's a good right. conservative. So yeah. What happens is when you have the far left and the far right and everybody but four people vote for this bill, it's a very important bill and we'll hopefully get done this year. Speaker Paulson has been very advocate about it too. He's been on Mighty Register. He's been on the radio about it. He went and talked to Majority Leader Gronstall about it. So we really hope this gets done this year. They have a chance and we've attached it to a few bills and hopefully that, and it would have passed with 96-2 the second time we went through the House. So the votes are there, and they have clearly enough votes in the Senate, too. Just the people that are in charge of putting it on the calendar are stopping it up.
Now, the folks who are pushing for this project, I've heard them, it must have been a radio interview, saying this isn't for recreational use. This is strictly because we need the water.
Not true. If it was just for the water, we wouldn't have a big problem about it. But they're going to put, I can't think of what, a resort on it. Or something along with condos where you have to rent so you can be by the lake, and so they can put boat and jet ski on it. And if it was just for the water, it wouldn't be nearly as fight because it's public good. But they say that's what they're trying to use that. Mm-hmm. But private investors are using condos and jet skis and everything else, so it's not only for the public good.
Representative Hagenow, your thoughts on eminent domain?
I just broadly, private property rights matter. I mean, these are one of these bedrock foundational liberties that we enjoy as Americans. And the threshold that you should have to clear to use eminent domain to take private property needs to be very high.
Yeah.
Higher than we've seen in other areas. I mean, you've seen the Kelo decision at the Supreme Court and what happened with that development. It's a wasteland now. Right. There's nothing there.
Right.
You shouldn't use eminent domain for economic development. And if it is for a legitimate public purpose, there ought to be a very high bar that you have to clear to do that.
Let's talk about something that you guys in the legislature have batted around for the last few years, and both sides have claimed to be in favor of it, but has not been able to get anything accomplished. And I think it's kind of taken the back burner, at least publicly this year, and that's property tax reform. Is anything happening, or is anything going to happen with this year?
Well, we just passed our version of the property tax bill again yesterday. It was actually the Senate's version. We amended it, put ours back on. We've passed that, I believe, over the past couple of years, six times, could give or take. We have changed our proposal several times to get it done. This is the latest version. We think it's a reasonable proposal. The main difference between the House and the Senate is the House version actually changes the rate. So it's predictable for property owners going forward so they can plan their business. whereas the Senate Democrat plan is a springing tax credit that may or may not be funded and may or may not even trigger based on how well the economy does. No business owner can plan on that.
Right.
So we want to work on it. We want to get something done, but it's got to be meaningful and predictable so that our business people can rely on it.
And of course, the question on, local city administrators and whatnot, they're concerned about the backfill, if the property tax isn't there. So is that accounted for in the House bill?
Yep. There is a full backfill. And they're also, now we've even changed the next, so it's a standing appropriation for the backfill. So the legislature does not need to act to fund that backfill. It will happen. Now, a future legislature could come in and unfund that, but I think that'd be a pretty risky political vote to do. So we're putting in place so that cities, counties, school districts are held harmless for this in the state, that state tax revenue will fill that up.
Okay.
And it's a good bill. It's a good proposal.
Representative Heifel, why is property tax reform such an important issue?
I'll start by saying one thing is that this is a very modest bill. For most of us, we want more. I promise the House Republicans want more, want more cut, want more thing. But this, we're willing to compromise with this bill just to get something done. Because if we don't get something done, next year they're going to jump up again because agriculture and residential are tied together, and you know how land prices are. You know how everything else is tied together. So the most important part of this bill for residential will take it from 4% growth to 2% growth, which is a big deal, especially in Johnston and Grimes, my home district. You know how fast Grimes is growing in the last 10 years. You live there.
Yeah, it's exploding.
You know how fast Johnston is growing. If we don't do this, we have no idea what's going to happen. Unpredictability. So many things are tied to our property taxes in Iowa, which is a huge problem in itself. So that's why we're so focused on stopping the growth of government intrusion and taxes and everything else. That's the most important part of the bill. We want more, but you know what? This is a good step in the right direction. And also, do you want to talk about the board of how people, when they appeal. Right.
The Property Assessment Appeals Board has been put in place where you can appeal to, if you don't like the valuation. I just got my new assessment roll in the mail, and if I disagreed with it, I could appeal to this board. Well, that board, when it was established a few years back, had a sunset date in it, and we've tried over and over to pass legislation we have passed in the House to extend that, to repeal the sunset date, because we have taxpayers with pending appeals that chose to go that path instead of district court. If we don't end that sunset clause, these folks that chose that path will simply be out and left out in the cold, and that we can't do that. So,
and the amendment passed the House we had that amendment to our bill, and every single Democrat voted for it, passed 98-0.
Let's talk about personal taxes a little bit. I know there's been efforts from both Republicans in the House and the Senate to offer tax credits, do a variety of different things with the surplus. Some people call it an overcollection of taxes. Anything going to happen with that?
The big thing with individual income tax that we passed in the House was the optional 4.5% flat tax. And you pick whichever one you want to pay. If you want to pay the higher one, I guess that's up to you. But
and this would cut taxes for, I believe, it's about 500,000 Iowans.
Yeah. No one would pay any more because you pick whichever one, presumably whichever one is lower.
Right.
And would offer the largest number of taxpayers are actually those in the $30,000 to $40,000 a year range in their adjusted gross income. So it applies all up and down the income ladder. So that's a live round. That's out there. I haven't heard that the Senate's really excited about it, but when you get to the end and all these issues are out there, there may be an opportunity. And so I know it's something that the House Republican Caucus is very excited about. One other tax bill that I actually had the chance to floor manage this year that I really like is an expansion of the school tuition organization tax credit.
Okay.
And I don't know if you followed that issue at all, but what that does is a 65% tax credit for donations made to tuition scholarship programs for private schools. And it actually, for some folks, can get them pretty close to making that donation and having it be not a tax neutral, but getting most of the money back in your taxes. And taking that from $8.75 million up to $12 million to provide scholarships for low income families to send their children to private school. It's a tremendous program. And I really hope we can get that one through the Senate. And I think we've got a shot on that one. That is just, it's a great program for kids to get to go to good schools.
Of course, the April 15th tax filing deadline just passed, and it was a brutal day for me because I'm self-employed. So, you know, I have to pay, you know, if you're most normal employees, your employer pays half your payroll tax and you pay the other half. If you're self-employed, you have to pay both of them. It was a painful day for me. Representative Heifel, your thoughts on tax reform and what could be done to help Iowans out?
I'll tell you what, our tax system up and down is completely flawed. We have too many deductions, too many everything else to make our system favor different people. I really would come down to a more flat system with no deductions. I think Ronald Reagan did that in his second term, took away all deductions, make it and go back. Sick and tired of having deductions here and there and everything else and make it harder for small businesses like yourself and self-employed. You should be helping people like you up more instead of a large corporation that obviously has very high paid accounts. I'm sure you don't have a $100,000 accountant doing the taxes for you. So, and I understand that's the one of the biggest things is that we need a more balanced, simpler approach. People don't have to work so hard to even figure out their taxes in the first place.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it was ridiculous. And I even had one of the well-known tax preparer companies do it. And I mean, I was in there for 2 hours and she had a heck of a time, you know, figuring out all the different stuff involved. It's just, it's the tax code is too long. It's too ridiculous. And it just, why not just make it simpler, fairer, and flatter?
I feel your pain. I'm a small business owner. I'm a partner in a small law firm. Mm-hmm. I pay self-employment tax. It is no fun.
No.
And it's a complicated process. And frankly, it's a disincentive for people to go into business.
Yeah, it is.
And we talk a good game about wanting to jobs in the economy and growing good jobs. And if the federal government were serious about that, they would work on simplifying the tax code specifically for small business owners because it's just obnoxious what you have to go through to get that done.
I agree 100%. Well, we got about 4 minutes or so left. So prediction time. Representative Hagenow, what do you see passing, major legislation passing this year? What do you think is going to kind of get left by the wayside that you know, conservatives and Republicans are really interested?
With regard to the legislature, I have learned to not make predictions. I know that, and I don't mean that to be a cop-out, but it seems like it's very often I make a prediction and I'm just dead wrong on it. So I take them as they come. I do think we will go past the May 3rd adjournment date. I think we will get done either mid-May or we will go well into June. One of
really?
The two. And I one other thing, I think there is a very realistic chance that we will have to come back for a special session. We want to do everything we can to avoid it, but there, if those differences become too great and there is not enough movement, that is possible.
Probably at the very least on in terms of the Medicaid expansion.
I think that's right, yeah.
Yeah. Representative Writing from Altoona predicted last weekend at his forum that he thought everything would be done May 3rd, but there would be a likelihood of getting called back. You don't think so?
Absolutely not. We passed all in appropriations. We passed all of our budgets, but one of the budgets probably about a month ago. And Senate Democrats have just done their first few. Was that Wednesday they were doing them? So we have a long ways to go. So we're going to reject them, go to conference committee. So I really do believe it won't be that late for this, but I'm almost 100% sure we're coming back for health care because that's all they want. They want Medicaid expansion more than anything else. Mm-hmm. And we want property tax. We want everything else. So I have a feeling we're going to come back for health care. I don't know when, but it'll be later in this year.
Hmm. Now, you guys both participate in these public forums that most of the legislators, easy for me to say, you guys do these public forums. What do the people who attend the forum say? And a lot of them are activists or lobbyists and have their, you know, or superintendents and have their own agenda. But what are you hearing from the common folks when you go to the legislative sessions?
When I go to the forums, Brad and I do our forums together, Senator Zahn, and we have always our school boards there almost every single time.
Yep. Same thing. I've noticed that in Urbandale. I've been to a few of those.
4%, they want 4% allowable growth.
Yeah.
They like our education plan, which is funny, because a lot of them are hard Democrats, you could probably imagine. Mm-hmm. When I go over to Grimes, the issues over there are some of the funnest issues you've ever seen because they talk about from guns to pro-life to eminent domain, everything, like, almost a good conservative. But I go to Johnston, it's more of a education, business stuff. So it's night and day, those 2 miles between the two towns. And I think it's hilarious. Brad goes, I'm never leaving Grimes. I'm like, me neither. It's just the greatest thing ever.
Representative Hagenow, out. What are your constituents saying to you? What's their, you know, main topic of interest?
You know, I've gotten a fair number of contacts on what we're doing with Medicaid on both sides of this, to expand it or to not to expand it. That seems to be a big issue. You know, we got out to the forums, and a lot of times the same folks come out to everyone. They're very interested in what's going on. They want to talk, and you kind of know what's coming ahead of time.
Right.
And you know what questions they're going to ask. But yeah, in my area, yeah, they want education reform. They're interested one way or the other on the Medicaid expansion. And a lot of the folks in my area are just very sensitive to their tax burden and what and seeing that their tax dollars are spent appropriately. And I like those questions because I think I have a pretty good record to talk about on that.
So. Absolutely. Well, gentlemen, it's been a very interesting hour and great discussion. I appreciate both of you stopping by. Yeah.
Thanks a lot,
very much.
That's Representative Jake Heifel from Johnston, Representative Chris Hagenow from Windsor Heights. You've been watching the Iowa Legislative Hour. I'm your host, Kevin Hall. Have a great weekend. You are watching Webcast One Live.